A little bit about myself. I have 15 family members from Louisiana, the fart under General Robert E. Lee in the Army of Northern Virginia. For several years, I did some reenacting, but after going back to war at the beginning of the century and a couple of those deployments, I kind of lost my thrill for pretending to be a living historian anymore. My beautiful wife, Rhonda, is here. We have two fantastic kids, and my daughter is down at Tulane University right now, my alma mater, so that's pretty exciting. All right, today, what we're going to talk about is you really can't talk about the occupation of Norfolk without understanding the history, the culture, and how Norfolk became a city. So I know many of y'all probably know the history, so I'm going to blaze through it very, very quickly. We're going to talk about the secession and how many times it took Virginia to vote to actually leave the Union. We're going to talk a little bit about the war here in Hampton Roads, because it was pretty exciting, and there's a lot of historical markers all over the area. We're going to talk about the Confederate actions, the Union occupation, and then we're going to get into post-war Norfolk. One of the most interesting things about Norfolk are the three seals right here from 1740, 1845, and the final one that was approved in 1913. And the interesting thing is they all carry the maritime flavor. The city of Norfolk went from, you know, looking at ship being built to a steamship, finally going back to its roots with a sailing ship. And in 1913, they added the words, and I'd like just to read the words to you because it's in Latin. It says, both by land and by sea the riches are. And at the bottom it says, and the city of Norfolk's motto is, thou shall grow. And as I go into this presentation, you're really going to see by land and by sea, Norfolk does grow. It's very, very interesting. Okay, so this is Norfolk's timeline. We're going to start way back, over 400 years ago, with King James I's charter, and we're going to end up all the way down to a Norfolk, and as well as Virginia, secedes from the Union and joins this young government known as the Confederate States of America. Okay, so here's the first charter. There's basically two charters that were awarded back in 1606. One was the Virginia Colony, the Virginia Company, and, oops, misfire. One was the Virginia Company, and it went along the East Coast, and then you also had the Plymouth Colony, which was settled a little bit later in 1620. What we're going to be focusing on is the area known as Hampton Roads, where the James River and the Elizabeth River come together and they pour into the Chesapeake Bay and they give you access out to the Atlantic Ocean. Norfolk starts to grow really around 1622. A couple of things really started the growth of Norfolk around 1622. One was there was a lot of Indian wars going on at the Jamestown Colony, which was really thinning out that settlement at the time. But what was one of the big things that made Norfolk so attractive around 1622? Anybody know? Shipping. Norfolk has the perfect trifecta. The trifecta, I call it, of access to the ocean, a deep natural channel that gets you to safe harborages. And that's what made Norfolk so attractive. Secondly, by about the 1620s, the English were kind of established in this area and the Spanish didn't mess with them very much. One of the reasons why Jamestown Colony had to be at least 20 miles upriver was so Spanish and other European nations wouldn't attack the young and early settlement. So Adam Thorogood gets a grant of land and tries to convince about 100 other settlers to come join him in this swampy little area that's right at the confluence of the James and the Elizabeth River. In 1624, Virginia becomes a colony for several reasons. The first is, the Indians were starting to thin out the colonists up there. The Virginia Company was running out of money. And lastly, they figured if it was a colony working directly for the king, then people could own land. And with their own land, they can grow tobacco. Tobacco is the cash crop around here. So 1636 is when it really starts to expand. A gentleman by the name of Willoughby gets another couple hundred acres, and he kind of pushes Norfolk a little bit to the east. Does anybody know why the city of Norfolk is called Norfolk? And it's got a long story behind the name, but I'm looking for the short, simple answer. Okay, Thorogood was from, let me get my notes please so I don't mess this up, New Norfolk County in England, and so that's what they called it down here. And it went through a series of several names, but it ended up being named after Norfolk, England. Okay, so Norfolk starts to expand. Tobacco requires a lot of land because we all know that the leaf really sucks all the nutrients out of the ground, so you have to constantly replant on new soil. So you have all this land, and if you have a whole bunch of land, what do you need?
Help.
You need labor. Okay, so let's talk about slavery just for 10 seconds or a minute or two, because this is really important, because this is all the Virginia colonies, and probably up north as well. There's really no moral basis for slavery, and I just want to go out there and say it straight up. But on the other hand, you can't take the lens of the 21st century and superimpose it on people that are trying to get started in a new world. Everybody knew it was wrong. Everybody accepted it as a culture. Everybody accepted it as a way of life, and quite honestly, it was a status symbol. So, and we're going to talk about this because the slaves that came specifically to Norfolk have a huge impact in Norfolk's history and the things that happen throughout the next couple of decades. So you have this agrarian society, you have the southern gentlemen, you have the plantations popping up, and what you have is a lot of growth. Norfolk is really being recognized as a major port. Again, that trifecta, access to the ocean, natural deep water channel, into safe harborages. So by 1670, Norfolk is already being recognized by the big people in England, specifically the kings, that this is an international city. You know, right now, we oil is kind of the major commerce, kind of makes the whole world go around when you think about it. Back during the 17th century, it was the spice trade coming out of the Caribbean, it was tobacco and cotton coming out of the colonies, and it's all heading towards Europe. And Norfolk's becoming an international shipping hub, and it's kind of getting quite famous. So it's an international port city. So by 1682, Norfolk accumulates a little bit more land. Now this map you're looking at right here is from the 1900s, okay? Also, Willoughby Spit has not been formed yet. There's a hurricane that blows through in the mid-18th century that sets that puppy up. But what I want to show you is ports of modern Portsmouth are part of Norfolk, and it's really contained along the Elizabeth River to the west and to the south, and really to the marshes, area where now the modern United States Naval Base is up there, by Sewell's Point. That's a lot of marshland, and so, you know, where we live in Larchmont right now, that's kind of like where the luxury houses were. That was when you went away for your country house to get out of the city. Okay, now Norfolk becomes a burg in 1736, and this is very important because now they have direct representation not just to the colonial government in Williamsburg, but they also have some representation in England as a borough, as part of the colony of Virginia. So this is really putting Norfolk on the map as a major player, once again, because of the shipping of the tobacco and the other goods that are coming grown in the colony, as well as being shipped up from the Caribbean. Okay, let's talk very quick about this gentleman here. Does anybody know who this man is? Dimwitty, thank you. Okay, so back in the Middle Ages, a mace was a weapon used to defeat the knights. So a small infantry guy would whack a heavily armored knight with this mace. By the 18th century, it's mostly a ceremonial piece. What we're looking at right here is Lieutenant Governor Dimwitty awarded this to the growing city of Norfolk. At the time, it had 4,000 people in its population, and the mace itself is 41 inches long, and it is made out of pure silver, probably worth a pretty penny. The mace symbolizes the governor's power, which came from the King of England. The mace is made with interlocking sections of silver and adorned with emblems of Great Britain. Okay, it was crafted by a British civil smith named Fuller White, and it is full of royal imagery, including the shield of the arms of Great Britain with emblems of the lands claimed by the British. Okay, here's some questions for you. What is the symbol of England?
Ireland. Rose.
Rose, thank you, sir. The rose. Scotland?
Thistle,
there we go. Ireland? Harp, there we go. And France?
Florida.
The fleur-de-lis. So those four images are on our mace, and then on top is the crown of St. Edward, which is used for all the British coronation ceremonies. This is a major piece of English silver at the time, they said, and there isn't that much English silver you could document with a history of use in early America. So this is very important. Let's just talk about Dimwitty. Let's take a quick sidebar for history. Dimwitty was very instrumental in starting the French and Indian War. And what young colonial officer did he send to go fight?
George Washington.
All right. So, as we all know, the English colonies did pretty good in the French and Indian War. And so, Norfolk continues to grow and prosper. And things are really good for about 15 years until the winds of revolution start blowing. And around 1775, the 13 colonies are starting to have enough of the English crown, and they're deciding that maybe they could go out on their own, except for Norfolk. Norfolk was a huge loyalist town. Why? Because they benefited from, even though being heavily taxed, they were a port city, and the more they shipped, the more taxes they paid, that meant the more money they were making. They did not want to upset the apple cart or the shipping dock, whatever you want to call it. So by 1775, while a good many folks are running up and down the 13 colonies, and by the way, November 10th, 1775, two battalions of Continental Marines were formed in Philadelphia, the folks in Norfolk are almost fiercely loyalist. So, towards the end of 1775, Lord Dunmore and many of his loyalists get on his command ship and many of the ships that made up the James River Fleet, and they set sail. And on New Year's Day, 1776, they start bombing Norfolk and they burn it to the ground. Now, a couple of cannonballs is not going to destroy everything. So some of the rebels kind of got involved when they saw the British were shooting on the city of Norfolk. They went around and started ransacking wealthy people's houses. They started starting the fires, making sure Norfolk burned to the ground. In fact, the only thing that remains from the American Revolution is this church here. And the most ironic thing is that the rebels were more than happy to blame the burning of the city of Norfolk on the British. They also secured a lot of arms and some wealth to help feed the young militia that turned into the Continental Army. And then lastly, they made sure that the city of Norfolk would not be used as a trade city or a port city throughout the American Revolution. And then they decided to bomb the city of Norfolk, initially just kind of as warning shots to scare the rebels away. Some cannonballs started a fire, and then the rebels did just added to the chaos. And then it's called the Burning of Norfolk. They are on New Year's Day, 1776. And so St. Paul's Church is the last standing building, and that cannonball there is still to this day if you'd like to go by and visit it. So the war goes on. We all have a very wonderful ending there at Yorktown in 1783. General Cornwallis surrenders to General George Washington. And so in 1783, the British blockade of Hampton Roads is finally lifted, and now Norfolk gets to rebuild. And rebuild it does. George Washington elected our first president. Fearing the British again or any other European power, he decided that we have to set up defense of what he called the maritime frontier. And the maritime frontier is really the eastern seaboard, major ports like Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, and specifically Norfolk because of our ocean access, natural deep channel, and our safe harbages. So work commences in 1795 for the Fort of Norfolk. And it's finally completed in 1810. Of note, during the War of 1812, although fully manned and fully ready to go, it never fired a shot in anger during that war. All right, so we move along. Norfolk is really put on the map in 1733. Does anybody know what this is? It's the first dry dock, stone dry dock in the Northern Hemisphere. This is significant. This makes Gosport Naval Yard one of the only places in the entire Northern Hemisphere to do major repairs on ships in a dry dock. And so here is the USS Delaware. Thank you so very much. It says it right there. Gosh darn it. I'm glad everybody brought their reading glasses. I didn't bring mine. So here's the USS Delaware coming in, and this is very significant. It happened on June 17th, 1833. The entire city came and celebrated, and it was just a very big deal because now Norfolk has the ability to do all these repairs. And once it's not just an international commerce hub, it's really part of now the shipping industry as well. Another thing that came out of the War of 1812 is that we didn't have enough major forts to defend major shipping areas. So right at the mouth of the Chesapeake Bay where it meets the James River, a decision is to build a huge stone fortress. So who was assigned there in 1831 as a young engineer to help complete building Fort Monroe? Rob, I love this crowd. Y'all are awesome. In addition to building Fort Monroe, they built another small little fort known as the Riprap, also became known as Fort Wool, after General Wool, who we'll talk about in just a few minutes. And you can see Fort Wool as you come out of the, you can probably see it really good because you're going really slow, come out of the Hampton Roads Bridge Tunnel, and it's right there off your right, and you'll see the American flag flying off of it. Okay. So Norfolk's population is exploding now. What's happening is that Europeans are coming to Norfolk in the droves, Germans, Scottish, French, and it's really, really growing very, very rapidly. We're enjoying the fortunes of peace after the War of 1812, and things are just coming along really, really nice. Norfolk's population is about 11,000 right now. Remember, that 11,000 does include slaves and free black labor. And now, the culture of Norfolk really starts to blossom. In 1841, a new school is built, and it's called Norfolk Academy. My daughter graduated from Norfolk Academy. And the temple, and it's built very similar to a temple that was in Athens, Greece. So they're not just trying to expand education, they're really trying to expand the culture of Norfolk and really put it on a map as a place that it's more than just a shipping hub. It's really a place that culture and education and religion is really blossoming as well. Of note, in 1847, the cornerstone for that building right there was laid, which is now the MacArthur Memorial. So in 1851, after much lobbying, because Congress and politicians don't always get along, a railroad is built connecting Norfolk to the industrial town of Petersburg. Now the politicians in Richmond and in Petersburg were infuriated with this because they knew this railroad would now take their goods, whether it be manufactured goods or whether it be raw agriculture goods. They now knew this railroad was going to take it right down to Norfolk, and that was going to expand Norfolk's commerce capabilities while degrading them. That's exactly what happened. So it took approximately 7 years for this to be built. Of note, while this was going on in 1855, what happened here in the city of Norfolk? Yellow fever. It killed the population, which now is almost 15,000. It killed one out of every three citizens. So now your city's back down to about 10,000. All right, so remember how I talked about Norfolk grew because of slavery and the free labor that came with it? Well, let's talk about another railroad. So probably going back, because it's not really documented very well, but going back probably to about the early 1830s, the Underground Railroad starts, and Norfolk really is the centerpiece of the Underground Railroad for the exact same reason why Norfolk became such a commerce hub, because of all the abilities to ship in and ship out, whether by wagon, by train, or by vessel. And so over the course of probably 50 to 60 years, 100,000 slaves from the South probably came through this area and went points north. I mean, I have a quote here from a history book. I don't want to mess up any of the specific stuff. This is just a sketch of the Underground Railroad, but here in downtown Norfolk, near the intersection of Main Street and Martin's Lane, that's really where the hub of the Underground Railroad was in the city of Norfolk. There was a dentist by the name of Charles Martin who had a slave named Sam Nixon. Nixon was the conductor of the Norfolk's Underground Railroad, which was the network of moving free slaves, either freedmen or escaped slaves, and moving them into transports and getting them out of Norfolk and getting them to points north, specifically Boston, Philadelphia, and New Bedford. So here we are. It's 1861. Who was the first state to secede from the Union? South Carolina, on December 20th, 1860. So winds of secession are now blowing through Norfolk, just like winds of revolution were blowing just 75 years prior. So Norfolk gets together on the 4th of April, and they send their delegates to Richmond. And there, Richmond had the secession convention, and they voted against secession on the 4th of April, 89 to 45. A week and a day later, a young son of Louisiana, General Pierre Gustave Toutant Beauregard, is in command of the Confederate forces at the mouth of the Charleston Harbor. And at 0430, on the 12th of April, 1861, he fires upon Fort Sumter. Battle lasted about 48 hours. The fort surrendered. President Abraham Lincoln was furious. On the 15th of April, he calls up for 75,000 volunteers. On the 17th of April, Virginia's secession convention meets again, and they vote to secede the Union, and several days later, they join the Confederacy. Upon Virginia leaving the Union, a series of events took place very rapidly. Fort Monroe is just to our north, as we know, and that was a major fort back then. There was really no northern defenses along Sewell's Point. The fort really protected the mouth of the Chesapeake into the James, and Fort Norfolk protected Norfolk along the Elizabeth River. So the Union forces start to get scared. They number about 600 that are here in Norfolk. And when I say Norfolk, I also mean Gosport Naval Yard, which is, like I said, modern-day Portsmouth today. So there's about 600 of them with a huge force at Fort Monroe. But Fort Monroe is not close when you're surrounded by a state that just seceded from the Union. So all the local militias are called out, and there's about 1,400 militia men that are now starting to surround Gosport and start taking valuable public and private property in the city of Norfolk. So the Union commander he's petrified, and he says, I can't let any of this fall into Confederate hands. Unbeknownst to him, a relief column, the USS Pawnee, is sortieing from Fort Monroe with an entire regiment of regulars coming down, which would have easily been able to hold Norfolk against the Confederates. But a young Confederate commander, General Mahone, well, actually he was a colonel at the time, Mahone, did a huge ruse to convince him that his army was stronger, so they start burning everything. They burn the shipyard, they tried to burn the dry dock, kind of hard to do it when it's made of stone, and they sank 11 warships that were there. They lit everything on fire. When the Pawnee came on, they all boarded the Pawnee, and then they set sail back for Fort Monroe, therefore evacuating Norfolk after burning many of the valuable military pieces of equipment that are around the Gosport Naval Yard. So this is what it looked like come the morning. And this is the list of ships. 11 warships were scuttled and destroyed by the United States Navy. Which one out there was the one that they tried to save and couldn't, and why? The Merrimac, and why? Why was the Merrimac so important? She wasn't an ironclad yet. She was steam engine. She was a steam frigate, brand new technology. She was the newest ship. She was the most expensive. In today's dollars, she would probably cost about 2 aircraft carriers in our DOD budget. It was an extremely expensive ship. She was there just getting some minor repairs. And so what they do is that they burn and destroy everything they can. 11 warships go to the bottom of the Elizabeth River. And this here is the Merrimac burning. Interesting thing about burning a ship, though, it can only burn to the waterline. Secondly, in order to sink the USS Merrimac, they bored holes in her hull, and it sank right down into that nice soft mud that I'm sure many of us have felt between our toes there in the Elizabeth River. Okay? That's not how you destroy a ship. That's how you put it underwater. They also found that a good many things that they tried to destroy and burn, like brick buildings, okay, you burn the inside, but we could rebuild it. You could spike a cannon, but I could fix the ignition system initiating system so this cannon could still fire. A lot of the machinery, they pushed into the river. They pulled it out of the river. So while the Union Army and Navy thought they did a good job destroying Gosport Naval Shipyard, they probably set it back about 6 weeks max, and then it was up and running again. Additionally, a lot of the weapons, munitions, and ammunition, and powder at Fort Norfolk was also confiscated for the Confederacy. So Norfolk's in pretty good shape. So here we are in 1861. A huge blockade is now really at the mouth of Hampton Roads, specifically because of Fort Monroe. So remember that swamp I told you that was kind of where the modern-day Navy base is? All that swamp's out there. So using a lot of slave labor, they went out there and they hastily dug some coastal batteries using a lot of the guns that they captured off the ships that sank. And now you have what's known as the Sewell's Point batteries facing to the north, while the big guns of Fort Monroe are now facing to the south. So what's going on here? Basically, Fort Monroe's taken, the Confederates burn Hampton as a maneuver north to go set up along dam number one, and they start setting up defensive positions to protect the lower peninsula from the forces coming out of Fort Monroe to maneuver north towards Richmond. And Fort Monroe is in Union hands, therefore supplies are coming in, and they're allowing some communication. In fact, the telegraph's a new kind of invention it's working on. They laid a cable from Washington, D.C. down to Fort Monroe, so now they have instantaneous communications between Fort Monroe and what's happening there up in Washington, D.C. About this time, what's known as the Fort Monroe Doctrine comes out. And our good friend, General Benjamin Butler, who we're going to talk about a few more times, he comes up with this doctrine, and he basically says this: if you're a slave, if you're a black man, if you're an indentured servant, if you're anybody who is not a free man, come to Fort Monroe and you'll be made free. And so right here, Colonel Mallory, who's one of the commanders of the Confederate forces on the peninsula, his slaves went away. And so here's a modern, a period drawing of his three slaves checking in. What they found out also is that when they became free men, they got a blue uniform and a musket and ended up in the Union Army. So, real quick, who's the commander-in-chief of the United States Army in 1861? Hero of the Mexican War? Winfield Scott. I'm sorry? Not yet. Halleck doesn't come around for another year. Who did Winfield Scott recommend to command the Union Army in the impending war? Robert E. Lee. So he came up with this plan called the Anaconda Plan, and everybody laughed at General Scott. The ironic thing, before I explain it to you, this is exactly what the Union ended up doing. It only took 4 years for them to do it. But his plan was to set up naval blockades around all the major ports, have a large land force maneuver from the Cumberland Valley in the Northern Gap, and march right down the Mississippi, destroying all the forts, securing the Mississippi River, coming into lower Louisiana, securing the forts down below New Orleans, and then therefore, you've cut the Confederacy in half, and you've isolated it, and now you're gonna strangle it, just like an anaconda snake would strangle its victim. So this is the early war plan. One problem, itty-bitty problem. The United States didn't have a navy to do all that. So what they ended up doing was they called it the Stone Blockade. They just took a lot of worthless old warships, because they still had ships from the War of 1812 that were just floating derelicts, but they took them out to all the major mouths of harbors and rivers and scuttled them with the idea that, okay, we're not going to blockade this harbor, we're certainly going to slow people down because nobody wants to hit a ship and fear either running aground or tearing your keel off your ship. So this is what the United States Navy's early answer is before they could build up their navy. So some pretty smart guys get together, and they look at the Merrimac sitting there in dry dock. You know, and this reminds you of, you know, everything you've ever seen of a mechanic. You know, he looks at a car that's been totaled and it's in 8,000 pieces, and he goes, "I can fix that." Well, that's exactly what they did with the Merrimac. Three engineers said, "I can fix that." They said the ship was scuttled, so let's unscuttle and refloat her. The steam room was fine. Propulsion system was fine. The screw was fine. The propeller. Fine. Okay, so the upper decks were burnt. So let's not make her out of wood. Let's make her out of iron. And let's put some of the biggest guns we have on this son of a gun, and let's go take care of that blockade out there. And that's exactly what they did. So not everything's happening just in Norfolk. There's other places happening. Northern Virginia, the Battle of First Manassas. Now here's a question. What do our good friends in the North call this battle?
Bull Run.
And why do we have two names for the same doggone battle? Closest terrain feature.
Yeah.
All right, and Confederates named it for?
City.
The nearest towns, cities, exactly. Not even gonna touch off on this. This is a very busy graphic of what shows you what comes out of the, shows you the maneuvering. Interesting things about the First Battle of Manassas. Huge battle. 18,000 soldiers on each side. Amateur army. General officers that are used to commanding about 50 troops are now commanding thousands of troops. It is what our European friends called the Battle of Amateurs, and it was. Uncoordinated attacks, unsupported attacks, units firing on friendly forces, just everything done wrong. But what are some of the outcomes of this battle? Number one, it showed that the Union Army can be defeated, because it was a sound Union defeat. I mean, the best folks of Washington, D.C. came out to watch it. And when they saw that the Union Army broke and ran, they tried to get back to Washington, D.C., so their civilian carriages, with the soldiers running away, just discombobulated this entire road network, and it allowed the Confederates to really pour in the fire. Of course, General Beauregard, after the battle, said, "I was more confused by winning the battle than my opponent was by losing the battle." But what it told everybody was, number one, there's going to be a lot of casualties in this war. Number two, this is going to be a long war. It's not going to be a quick strike. And it also showed the Confederate Army has the ability to do something on the battlefield. So the very next day, on the 22nd of July, President Lincoln signed a new enlistment order saying 500,000 men must be called up. So now you have this huge army being formed. The Confederacy did not have the manpower to match the Union. Enough said on that. What I want to do real quick, and this slide takes about a minute to build, so I'll chit-chat while it's building. I like this slide, number one, because I made it. Number two, because it kind of just gives you a nice, easy graphic of the major battles and campaigns, which are listed on the bottom of the timeline, and it compares with some of the major, some I said, not all, because there's not enough room, major political events on the northern end of the slide. You know, it's really interesting when you see in April 1861, Confederate States Capitol is moved from where? Montgomery, Alabama, to Richmond, Virginia, right? It's the exact same time Virginia seceded from the Union. It happened on the 17th of April, almost the exact same day. So as this goes on through, you can see a lot of battles. You also see kind of like a break in battles in the wintertime. Both armies went into winter quarters because it was kind of miserable out there. Plus, the black powder didn't tend to want to go off very well when it was cold and wet outside. So here's my timeline. The war ends beginning of April there in 1864. Unfortunately for the United States of America, Abraham Lincoln is assassinated 5 days later. What we're going to talk about really tonight as we talk about the impact of the occupation of Norfolk are these two events here. One, McClellan's Peninsula Campaign, and Mike kind of teed me up that I do give a very interesting class, my words, not his, on the Peninsula Campaign for St. Patrick's. And secondly, the fall of New Orleans, because there are some parallels between the New Orleans falling and Richmond being, I'm sorry, Norfolk being occupied. So very quickly, let's look at the Confederate situation here in 1861. Very sad state of affairs. So for the first time ever, you have a bunch of country boys that are now put in quarters. What do you think happens when you take people from isolated lands and you put them grouped together? Diseases comes through. Disease spread through that camp, and it wiped out almost a third of the Confederate Army. Most of the Northern soldiers were inoculated. The Confederate soldiers were not. Very inexperienced leaders, kind of talked about that already, disease epidemics. And lastly, the Furlough and Bounty Act. I mean, I would have jumped on this in a heartbeat. I got $50 and 3 months furlough to go home and see my family, to square matters away, and then come back to the Army. The problem is only about half the soldiers came back. So then lastly, General Johnson and President Jefferson Davis make a decision. They say, you know what, we need to withdraw our forces because they're still holding way up north because of the Battle of First Manassas. They said, let's just move everybody south of the Rappahannock. Let's consolidate there, understanding using that natural terrain river, terrain feature of the river as a barrier, and let's set up here. So Confederate Army is now settled down here. Not a lot of forces here in Norfolk per se. The Navy's busy building their super secret weapon. You have a few local regiments of militia, and that's it here. Down in Norfolk. Union is just in bad a shape, but they just have a whole lot more of them. So on the 5th of November, McClellan is appointed the General-in-Chief of the entire Army. He has an army of almost 180,000 men, all in Washington, D.C., and it was a cesspool back then, even worse than the cesspool it is today, because they were all sitting there in a swamp along the Potomac River. So he's manning, training, and equipping his army, this magnificent army, and so after Christmas, Lincoln gets frustrated. He even says at one point to his Secretary of War, if McClellan's not going to use this army, maybe I could borrow it and get on down to Virginia. And so by early February, McClellan comes up with a plan, which is basically his Peninsula Campaign plan, to do an amphibious landing at Fort Monroe and then shoot up the peninsula between the James and the York River and capture Richmond because they were very focused on the capital of Richmond. So that's how what's happening up north. What else is happening down here? I'm not going to talk about the Pinkerton spies because they were kind of funny. But there are different spies down here. The most effective spies for the United States Army were black slaves. Remember I told you there was an education renaissance beginning around the the mid-19th century? Well, a fair number of slaves could actually read and write. Many arrogant white men did not know that. So there was a young lady by the name of Mary Trostrow, who was a freed slave and was working as a housekeeper for the lead engineer working on the CSS Virginia. Every night, these gentlemen would get around and just talk about how important their project was and how they're going to save the Confederacy by bursting that Union blockade with their iron ship. This woman's listening, and she's like, holy cow, somebody needs to know this. So she sneaks in one night and steals the entire plans for the CSS Virginia. She makes her way using the well-established Underground Railroad, and she ends up in Washington, D.C., and she actually briefs the United States Secretary of Navy and says, sir, I am not pulling a fast one. This is what these boys are building, and it's going to be ready in the spring of 1862. Well, the United States was very slowly, very patiently thinking about ironclads themselves because they heard rumors. And they said, you know what? If this thing is for real, we need to accelerate our plans. And like now, we need to build it and finish it now. So they got this Swedish engineer who built and designed the what became the USS Monitor. And it was revolutionary because it had a revolving turret. And it only had two guns compared to the 10 guns that are on the Virginia. But these two huge Dahlgren naval guns and a revolving turret on an ironclad changed the face of naval warfare for the next 200 years. A lot of historians believe, they say this right here is a turning point in the war, because had the CSS Virginia been able to be built and had it done what it's going to do in March of 1862 without having to fight another ironclad, then the blockade would have been broken, the potential of Europe sending assistance into Norfolk would have occurred, and it could have changed the stake of the war. So I really think it's important to mention what the spies were doing, not just, like I said, the Pinkerton spies, and I could talk all night long on those characters, but I'm talking about very intelligent black people that were working as either slaves or servants that realized, holy cow, this intel needs to get to the United States. And I'm just giving you one of many, many examples out there. So now it's the summer of 61. We're living under a blockade, but things aren't that bad because we're not getting bombed, we're not getting burned here in Norfolk. By February of 62, the CSS Virginia is being finished up. In fact, on the 6th of March, when she's ready to go on out, they put in a big newspaper article because, believe it or not, the number one source of intelligence back then was each other's newspapers. They ran a big newspaper article here in whatever it was called before the Virginia Pilot, and it said, that rusty piece of iron can't even float. The guns don't work. The steam engine's all busted. It's going to be months before we could get her out. The Union figured out, since the Confederates were complaining so much, that that thing was ready to go to war. And ready to go to war it was. So there's three warships laying off Fort Monroe with several more on the other side, kind of on the Chesapeake Bay side of Fort Monroe. And on the 8th of March, history is made as a steam ironclad with fixed guns sallies out and basically uses a ram to sink one ship, uses her guns to blow another one to smithereens, and while another ship ran aground and was attempting to surrender, cannon fire, musket fire from Fort Monroe was being placed upon the USS, I'm sorry, the CSS Virginia, and the commander was killed. I'm sorry, he was seriously wounded. And the Confederates were so upset that they would shoot on them while they were trying to help the sailors that were surrendering. They shot and burned the USS Congress right there at the base of Fort Monroe. So now we have what's known as the Battle of Hampton Roads. The graphic in the upper left-hand corner kind of shows the ships I was just talking about, the Minnesota, the Congress, and the Cumberland that were all destroyed on the 8th of March. So the captain wanted to stay out there and keep fighting. Lieutenant Jones, he took command. He said, let's keep fighting. Let's keep going after these Union ships. The river pilot said, hey, we have to get over this thing called Craney Island. Back then it wasn't an island. It was just a kind of a shoal. They said, we draw a lot of deep water and the tide's going out. If we don't go back now, we're going to get stuck here. So they come back to Norfolk. They do a little rest and refit. Goes back out on the morning of the 9th of March. Well, that night, unbeknownst to anybody, this little slimy cheese box looking thing with water washing over her decks shows up. And for the first time in naval history, you have an iron ship battling an iron ship. It goes on all afternoon long. Each side took fairly significant blows. Each side took casualties. The captain of the monitor got wounded when a round exploded right at the vision port, and it shot through, and he got some timbers in his eye. The monitor took some really good beatings because the monitor had a maneuver in order to bring her guns to bear. The Virginia had a maneuver while the monitor had that swinging turret. Very interesting difference in the ships. Also, the monitor didn't draw the same depth, so it could get closer to Fort Monroe, and when it did, the big guns at Fort Monroe would shoot at the CSS Virginia. So as the sun set on the 9th of March, the decision was, hey, we'll re-engage tomorrow. So with the flowing out tide, both ships kind of make it back. It's a tactical draw, but the ironclads never battle again. Even though the CSS Virginia, we'll talk about this in a minute, does multiple sorties to kind of say, hey, kind of like Moulin La Bay, I'm over here, if you want me, come and get me. But what happens is now is that the Virginia needs to go into dry dock, and it sits in dry dock for a month. So while the Virginia's in dry dock, let's jump a little bit down to my favorite city, down in New Orleans. So real quick, you have Admiral Farragut that needs to take the city of New Orleans to cut the Confederacy. And I just show this real quick because there's some parallels here. New Orleans capitulates. There's not really a battle there. What's interesting is that the Union soldiers go up to General Andrew Jackson, the hero of the Battle of New Orleans in January of 1815, and they put the Union must and shall be preserved on his statue. The commander of New Orleans ultimately is Spoons Butler. Anybody know why they called him Spoons? He stole a lot of their silver. Allegedly. So he gets the nickname as the Beast of New Orleans. So now, the city of Norfolk has very few options. Its best warship comes out of dry dock, and it sallies forth several times throughout April, trying to engage the monitor and try to engage the other ships of the Union fleet. By now, the Union has also sent two more ironclads down, but all the ironclads are under orders, do not engage the Virginia. Because of the Virginia's depth, and because of the damage she sustained, she really couldn't go up the Richmond, and she couldn't bust out to get into the ocean, so she was really confined to the Elizabeth River. Very frustrating for the sailors of the Virginia. So the decision is made in early March, because what's happening, let's go back here just for a second, I'm sorry. So what's happening is McClellan's army is growing on the peninsula, and at the exact same time he has Yorktown under siege. The Confederates are like, the soldiers that are occupying Norfolk, we need them in Richmond, we need them in Richmond now, and the Virginia isn't doing much good for you anymore. So I think it's time to start thinking about militarily abandoning Norfolk, Virginia, and that's exactly what happens. The Confederates, a little bit more effective than the Union at destroying Gosport Naval Yard. They blew up the dry dock, they blew up all the facilities, they blew up everything they couldn't take with them. They dragged all the guns, though, from all the ships and from Fort Norfolk up to Richmond, and those guns fired throughout the rest of the war, defending Petersburg and defending Richmond years later into the war. So, believe it or not, the man who actually organized and planned the landing in Norfolk for the 10th of May, 1862 was?
Lincoln.
Abraham Lincoln, yes sir. Lincoln came down to see why McClellan was dragging his feet with his peninsula campaign. Now he's a month into it and he hasn't even taken Yorktown yet. And so Lincoln's looking at Norfolk and he says, we need to do something. While the batteries on Sewell's Point weren't that strong and they weren't preventing the river from being open, it was an eyesore having Norfolk occupied while they're trying to do the campaign. Once they heard from spies, more than likely escaped slaves, saying, hey, they're burning everything and they're pulling out of Norfolk, Lincoln started panicking. He saw how they burned Hampton and it kind of destroyed some of the morale effort. And so he said, we don't want Norfolk to the burn. So he grabbed General Wool and he said, go down there and I want you to take Norfolk. The army has already been marched off. General Wool lands with 6,000 soldiers. It's an unopposed landing. All the batteries at Sewell's Point were basically, the guns themselves were taken away and marched off to Richmond. So he lands unopposed. He comes up from Sewell's Point. He marches due south and he comes right here where the mayor, William Lamb, meets him. And he says, sir, the city is yours. So the very next day, the CSS Virginia is really of no good to anybody anymore. So the Queen of the Navy, unfortunately, is not scuttled by her own crew. She's blown to smithereens by her own crew. So as Abraham Lincoln was taking off to go back to Washington, D.C., with the outgoing tide, he saw bits and pieces of the CSS Virginia floating down the Elizabeth River into the James and out through the Chesapeake Bay. So real quick, I spent 2 hours talking about this slide alone in my class, but this kind of just really shows you what's going on. And of note, and I'll talk really loud here, you know, March 17th is when they land here, after the Battle of Hampton Roads, which was the 8th and 9th of March, and then they start going on up here. And so it's May 10th, so basically the Army here is coming right out of West Point. There's somewhere here along the Pamunkey River is when Norfolk capitulates and surrenders to the Union Army. So let's talk a little bit about the occupation in Norfolk, because after all, that is the topic of tonight's talk. All right, so this slide takes us all the way to the 31st of May, Battle of Seven Pines. A Confederate general was shot trying to rally troops that night. Who takes command the next morning? General Lee. And that forever changed the course of the war there. So now for the duration of the war, the city of Norfolk is under martial law. General Benjamin Butler was a military governor. There's old Spoons right there. And the provost general officer is General Egert Veal. He's in charge of all the police functions. So the people of Norfolk tried to return back to a normal life, but there were many hardships. And it proved to be extremely difficult because Norfolk was based on being a maritime and mercantile commerce system. That's what the whole city was based off of. But now the city's in shambles. Routines are disrupted, people have been displaced, and the city's under martial law. There are two indignities, great indignities, that the people of Norfolk had to suffer during the occupation. The first was that it was enforced upon them that they had to take a public pledge to their allegiance to the United States. Well, to us, once again, in the 21st century, you're like, duh. But back then, you know, they voted with an open conscience to secede. And who voted? It was white guys. It was people like me. Okay, it wasn't the slaves voting, it wasn't the women voting, it was the white men voting. So by being forced to take this pledge to the United States and being told that all black men are free and all black men are equal, even though it says that in our Constitution, it really cut at the fabric and this culture of Norfolk. So this is a great indignity right there, because it also made the people of Norfolk feel like they were conquered, and they really weren't. I mean, the Army and the Navy abandoned them, and they got stuck there. And they felt they shouldn't have to give their allegiance to a conquering power, because that's how they viewed the United States. And the people of Norfolk resisted at every turn. I'm going to read this to you, what it says, real quick. But in conjunction with taking allegiance, basically every private and public building was open to the United States Army. And so they were confiscated for federal use, including all the nearby plantations. Many wealthy locals were concerned that the Union troops would confiscate their personal items, such as silver. And so they tried to hide as much as they can. And Norfolkians, just like my family, the New Orleanians, saw Benjamin Butler as a harsh, ruthless occupier. This plaque right here, it says, and I'll read it to you, "This house was built in 1807 as the country residence of Dr. William B. Selden. During the federal occupation of Norfolk, 1862 to 1865, it was seized and occupied as the headquarters of the federal commanders. On his last visit to Norfolk, April 1870, General Robert E. Lee was a guest here and of his personal friend, Dr. William B. Sheldon, surgeon, Confederate States of America." And where is this? Freemason and Bochart. So what I love so much about Norfolk is the exact same thing what I love about New Orleans. History is everywhere you look, even in a quiet little neighborhood. So I said there were two great indignities. First, they had to swear allegiance to the United States, and they lost all their public and personal property. The second was more of a bitter pill to swallow. Enslaved African Americans did not wait until the end of war to be emancipated. With the arrival of the Union troops, thousands of slaves escaped to Norfolk and Fort Monroe to claim their freedom. Norfolk citizens were forced to show respect for and take orders from former slaves, many of whom were now federal soldiers keeping law and order on the streets of Norfolk. And this is a direct quote from the period. "Norfolk's cup of bitterness was full when federal authorities began recruiting the slaves, organizing them into regiments, and using them for garrison duty or expeditions into the surrounding county. To see Negro soldiers drilling in the streets was bad enough, but to have them arrest some old school Southerner or ransack his home or stand guard over him in prison was almost too much to be endured. So Norfolk now is being, by bayonet, being forced to culturally shift its way of life, shift its thinking, and shift its culture. So Fort Norfolk never fired a shot during the war. The Confederates took all the guns. They ended all up around either Petersburg or Richmond in defense. But it was used as a federal prison. And General Butler, for all his evil doings, the one thing that he was good at was prisoner exchanges. So a fair number of Confederate soldiers were released from Fort Norfolk in exchange for federal prisoners of war. Okay. The city starts slowly to be rebuilt. People are accepting that the new police soldiers or their previous slaves carrying guns and telling them what to do. But Norfolk's going to do what Norfolk's always done. So it slowly starts doing commerce. It starts having ships sailing to the Caribbean, to northern ports, to Europe. And even though it's not supposed to, the federal authorities are kind of turning a blind eye. They're getting their cut just like the king got their cut when they were a colony. So everybody's getting paid, and Norfolk is slowly returning to normal, slowly becoming the commerce hub it was, although illegally, but the federal authorities allowed a lot of this commerce to commence because now they didn't have to provide for the people of Norfolk. Norfolk was kind of self-sustaining, and as long as no mischief was going on or any sabotage going on, they allowed this to happen. So this, remember, Norfolk was very loyalist at the beginning of the American Revolution. A lot of the folks that were in the commerce business did not really want secession. So a lot of the old Norfolkians, a lot of the people in Norfolk were allowed to go back to what they did best, and that's international commerce. So as the two great armies evacuate in early spring of 1865 from the siege of Petersburg, they start maneuvering their way down towards a little quiet town called Appomattox, which is nothing more than a railroad intersection. And while they prepare General Lee and General Grant for their meeting there at Appomattox Courthouse, President Lincoln comes down almost about the same time, and he starts talking with Confederate officials and the leaders to start talking about Reconstruction and what Norfolk is going to do as a major international city to help the United States help Norfolk reassimilate back into the United States. So he comes on down here, and he has a really good conversation, and a lot of people in the city of Norfolk are very excited about the future. The war is ending, and they could get back. But what they're getting back to is a new normal. It's not what they knew before. Slavery is gone. The free labor is gone. A lot of the wharfs and warehouses, although being repaired, are still in shambles. They're transitioning. You're going from sail to steam. It's a new era. Things are going on. So while there's a lot of hope and there's a lot of excitement, there's also still a lot of bad blood. And so there's a riot in 1866 because during Reconstruction, a lot of the soldiers stayed in the southern cities. I could tell you stories of what my family endured in New Orleans during Reconstruction. And so it's no better here for the folks in the city of Norfolk. This is a clipping from a newspaper article that just talks about how some of the folks said the war is over, we should get back to normal, not understanding that their previous life will never be the same again. And many folks had a slow time understanding what the future was. So here we are, Norfolk's timeline. You know, some things are made the same. I mean, I have a quote here, and I think this is really important because I kind of sense this just a little bit being here as well. But with the war over, things start coming. A rail system's put inside the city. The railroad's rebuilt. It's going back to being its international commercial hub. Norfolk's growing. And to this day, you could see what we have here with the shipyards and Norfolk Southern and everything. It's very exciting. And so Norfolk is really starting to grow. But at the same time, Norfolk has always been a welcome harbor for people from other countries, especially if you are from parts of Europe and you could contribute to the local economy. Historically, Norfolk was never a town of great upward social mobility. Because of its small town localism, Norfolkians always seem to only have a few degrees of separation between themselves and anyone else they need to know. Some people call the social class of Norfolk as being both prescribed and static. Nobody in and nobody out. And that kind of wraps up for tonight. My reference, this is a wonderful book. I got real excited when I got this book out of the library because I thought this was going to give me information on the occupation. This book is about 110 pages, and it dedicates about three paragraphs to the occupation. All right, thank you very much. It was wonderful being here tonight.